Hello, honeys, and welcome to a brand new edition of the Bees-ness. This week we'll be looking back at June 30th through July 6th. As per usual, we have about five main categories for you today: follow-ups, institutional and legal, auction sales events, announcements and discoveries, and everything else. We've got juicy headlines in each and every category today, so let's dive in. Starting with our follow-ups, it was announced last week that the proposed move of the Mona Lisa would not be funded by the state, says news sources. The Louvre has put semi-official estimates for this proposed change, the construction, at 50 million euros, but the Culture Ministry source says, quote, "This is only an idea put forward by Descartes, and if it ever becomes a project, the state will not participate in the funding," end quote. Now, if you remember from the Bees-ness where we introduced this idea of potentially changing the viewing conditions of the Mona Lisa, it is kind of necessary. So why did the Culture Ministry say no? Two reasons. First, cost. Especially with the huge Olympic investments being made this year, France is very hesitant to put forth that 50 million euros for a single painting, even the Mona Lisa. And the second is time. Construction estimates are currently running at about 10 years. The publication Art newspaper reports that efforts to make the goal more attractive to funders and the board center on these problems of overcrowding that will not change. Descartes has indicated hopes to create a more attractive offer for potential funders by combining the renovations of Mona Lisa's room as well as the entrance hall under the infamous Pi Pyramid in the center of the square for improved conditions all around the museum. Of course, we have yet to see if that will be successful. In our most recent Bees-ness, we talked about an Onderdonk painting that was saved from Goodwill. CBS News reports that on June 29th, the painting, named A Field of Bluebonnets, San Antonio, sold for $112,500, noting that in the same auction, two other Onderdonk works sold for nearly $106,000 and nearly $94,000, respectively. Another quick update, a little older, but first time I'm actually seeing one on the topic, the sale of Vivienne Westwood's wardrobe and designs caught more than 750,000 pounds or 961,000 US dollars at that Christie's London sale a few weeks back. And in light of the new attacks as well as the ongoing decisions to build a road tunnel nearby it, UNESCO has officially proposed putting Stonehenge on its danger list. A draft written decision from the World Heritage Committee suggests adding Stonehenge to the list, and that proposal will be voted on in July's meeting of the committee in New Delhi. Concerns remain about this move to redo the road, a push that's existed for decades, especially as Liverpool was stripped of its World Heritage status in 2021 after the UN committee claimed developments threatened the heritage value of the city's waterfront. UK cultural officials are very worried about the same fate for the iconic site. In our auctions, sales, and events news, first up, the city of Newport welcomed a display of 100 life-sized elephant statues last week. The exhibition, called The Great Elephant Migration, started on the 4th of July and runs throughout August as a traveling art exhibit that is meant to encourage humans to share space. According to the project's own website, it is particularly aimed at helping nonprofit organizations that are indigenous-led. The 100 statues were handcrafted by a community of 200 indigenous artists, known as the Coexistence Collective, all from India's Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve over the last 5 years. The show is operated by Elephant Family USA, a UK-registered charity working to protect Asian wildlife. And each of those elephant statues is paired with a conservation nonprofit that benefits from the proceeds of the sales of the elephant sculptures at the end of the exhibition. This includes the local organization Save the Bay, which works to help fund initiatives that remove invasive reeds found in local salt marshes. We're including this story today, honeys, because it's a very creative fundraiser and a great way to promote community, both local and international. The last week-ish also saw the announcement that Elton John is now selling his clothes on eBay. The sale of hundreds of items from the 77-year-old musician's personal closet is in fact a fundraiser, with all proceeds going to his Elton John AIDS Foundation. The items range in style, designer, and personal era, including everything from Gucci jackets to Versace robes and customized Prada loafers. Some of the more affordable items to be included in the sale will be baseball caps, historic concert t-shirts, the like. The 10-day auction kicked off on Thursday of last week, timed to coincide with Pride Month. The Superstars Foundation aims to end the AIDS epidemic by 2030. Though we may prefer not to talk about the author these days, it is notable last week that the original Harry Potter cover art sold for $1.9 million, setting a new auction record. The piece in question is the original illustration for the first edition of Rowling's 1997 novel, Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone. The art was originally expected to sell for up to $600,000, the highest pre-sale value ever placed on a Harry Potter-related item, according to auction house Sotheby's, but clearly that was underestimated. According to Sotheby's, it took 10 minutes for the four-way bidding war to conclude in New York on Wednesday. Circling back to the art itself for a second, it's a watercolor image created by author and illustrator Thomas Taylor, featuring the young wizard ready to board the Hogwarts Express. The version was used not only for the UK version, but across multiple translated ones, just not the US edition of the book, released under the title Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone. Taylor was only 23 years old at the time of the image creation, did it in just 2 days, according to Sotheby's, while working at a bookshop. Pretty unique and amazing underdog story. Lots of heads turned last week when the headline Bruce Lee Unseen Photographs exhibition opens in Hong Kong was released, including my own, so here's the story there. The show presents a collection of previously unseen photos and original photographic films from Lee's final film, The Game of Death. It's only open a short time, June 27th through July 16th, so rush on over there and tell me what it's like. The Detroit Ace Honors Ceremony happened last week, and multiple Detroit arts legends were celebrated therein. The Detroit Office of Arts, Culture, and Entrepreneurship, or ACE, marked its fifth anniversary by announcing the 2024 honors winners, celebrating fine and performing artists who have given 25 years or more in service to the Detroit arts scene. A few of those very impressive people included Marion Hayden, a Detroit-born jazz bassist and educator, Madeline Porter, an actress, storyteller, comedian, and creator of several one-woman shows, the master visual artist Hubert Massey, as well as George Namdi, an art dealer, gallery owner, and renowned curator as well as collector. ACE director Rochelle Riley praised Mayor Mike Dugan at the event for not only establishing the office, but in her own words, for providing a wonderful way to fight for the city's artists, to promote the city of Detroit and its art scene to the rest of the world. The event also saw the release of Detroit ACE's Quint Report, a 120-page book outlining the accomplishments and impact of the office over the last 5 years as it works to strengthen the city's creative workforce during those ceremonies. Honeys, I've included this story because it's proof of what I've been saying to you all along. The arts matter, and they can make a huge difference in a local community. Shifting gears over to stories grounded in institutions and the legal world, on Thursday, Cambodia welcomed the Met's repatriation of 14 total centuries-old statues looted during past turmoil. Slight misread there, honeys. They arrived Wednesday. It was Thursday that Cambodia's culture minister said that their return is like, quote, welcoming home the souls of ancestors, end quote. On their return, the statues were displayed to journalists and VIPs at the National Museum in the Cambodian capital in Phnom Penh. The museum noted that likely made between the 9th and 14th centuries in the Angkorian period, they reflect the Hindu and Buddhist religious systems prevailing at that time. Last week also saw the launch of the nation's first pack led by drag performers, alumni of RuPaul's Drag Race. The six veterans of the show, including Jinx Monsoon, Ben de la Creme, Peppermint, and Monet Exchange, announced this official launch Thursday morning. Said Dylan Bulkelly Crane, one of Drag Pack's organizers, quote, "Drag queens have always kind of been our community leaders in the queer community, and they're some of our most public-facing and boldest and bravest community members," end quote, indicating that this sort of action is not terribly surprising. This is especially true as the Drag Pack's launch comes amidst a tidal wave of legislation targeting LGBTQ+ people across the country. This includes the more than 500 anti-queer bills that were filed this year in state legislatures, according to the ACLU, 39 of which became law. The first action of the PAC's drag performers earlier this week was to meet with House lawmakers on either side of the aisle to lobby for the Equality Act, which is federal legislation that would make sexual orientation as well as gender identity protected classes. They also discussed the Transgender Bill of Rights, a landmark resolution that would strengthen civil rights protections for trans and non-binary Americans. The main focus of the PAC through the end of November will be to leverage the drag stars' large social media platforms to drive their fans to the polls. Kanye West also settled his lawsuit for using Donna Summers' song in Vultures 1 without permission as of last week. The rapper sampled Summers' 1977 I Feel Love in his 2024 album despite being denied permission by the late singer's estate. As a result, Summers' widower and her estate's executor, Bruce Sodano, brought a lawsuit forth in February claiming that both West and Ty Dolla $ign, a collaborator on the album, had violated copyright law. The suit was filed in federal court in LA, adding that the Summer estate denied permission because they wanted, quote, "no association with West's controversial histories," end quote. Lawyers for both parties announced at the end of June that they had entered a mutually agreed upon final and full settlement agreement. And running tight on time, so we're just going to go with one very important discovery this week, that of the oldest ever cave painting, which has officially changed origin assumptions about cave painting. Scientists discovered the artwork depicting three human-like figures interacting with a wild pig on the ceiling of a limestone cave on the Indonesian island of Sulawesi. They used a new scientific approach of using a certain laser to date a type of crystal called calcium carbonate that formed naturally on top of the painting in order to determine its creation date, which was at least 51,200 years ago. They then used the same dating method to reassess the age of another local Sulawesi cave painting at a site called Liang Bulu Sipong 4, which also has a narrative scene and turned out to be upwards of 4 older than previously believed. So why do we care, honeys? Well, this discovery drives home the point that Europe was not the birthplace of cave art as had long been assumed. The Independent writes, quote, "Liang Kurumpong painting," the researchers said, "predates the cave paintings of Europe, the earliest of which is at El Castillo in Spain, dating to about 40,800 years ago. And because the researchers were able to interpret this as a narrative scene, it is the oldest known evidence of storytelling in art, period. And one very last one for the memes. We're going to talk about the wax Lincoln sculpture that melted, why it existed, and its sad, sad demise. After suffering record temperatures in the outdoor Washington, D.C. heat last week, the sculpture sat in front of the Lincoln Memorial was ruined. Lincoln's head flopped back across his chair, melting away almost entirely. and many began memeing about the president looking annoyed, slouching, or embodying a metaphor about current affairs in the US of A. The sculpture by Sandy Williams IV is part of a contemporary art installation intended as a commentary on the permanence of monuments. It has gained a whole new meaning for online observers, according to the New York Times, who have made serious connections between it and environmental concerns. Williams himself said that although he knew someday he would need to be concerned about the heat and this being a wax piece, he, quote, didn't expect that point to be this past weekend, end quote. He rather expected that damage to come from the wicks built into the work that are intended to be burned slowly over time by visitors who are asked to light and then blow them out. Williams has been making wax versions of historical monuments all along the East Coast for the past 4 years, and this particular one, the Lincoln Memorial model, has been displayed on the lawn of Garrison Elementary since February. It will be sold to a private collector or larger gallery, likely before August, so that some of it remains to sell. We'll wrap it up right there, honeys. Thank you for joining me again for another Bees-ness, another rundown of the arts world headlines from the last week. Look forward to seeing you again soon, especially as we are dropping that Mysteries of the Last Supper episode on Thursday. Please tune in to learn some new things about the world's most iconic artwork, and talk to you soon. Take care of yourselves until then. This podcast was created, produced, written, posted, edited, and fact-checked by master's graduate Celia Bugnow. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe on all of your favorite streaming platforms as well as your social medias.